off right away and not have any little introductions at this point, and just get things rolling, and I'll do some other little introductions and as we go along. So our first reader is Gillian Conoley, and this is her new book from Omnidawn. It's called The Plot Genie. And Gillian is the author of 6 collections of poetry, including Profane Halo, Lovers in the Used World, and Tall Stranger, which was a finalist for the National Book Critics Circle Award. She has received the Jerome J. Shestock Poetry Prize from the American Poetry Review, a National Endowment for the Arts grant, and a Fund for the Poetry Award. She lives in San Francisco, in the San Francisco Bay Area, with her husband, novelist Dominic Stansberry, and their daughter Gillis. She is poet in residence at Sonoma State University, and she edits Volt. Would you welcome, please, Gillian Conoley?
Thank you. Okay. What a nice audience you are. So, long live Omnidawn Press. And long live Mo's Books. And Owen Hill. And long live us all. Hi.
Okay. So, what should I do?
The Plot Genie is named after a plot. Is the microphone's okay? It's not too loud or anything? Okay. The Plot Genie is named after a plot-generating device that was created in the 1930s by ex-silent screenwriter Wycliffe A. Hill. And it was a series of volumes, and it came with a cardboard wheel that a writer was supposed to spin to get certain numbers and then create a plot. It was like a chance operation thing. And I invented several characters for this book. They're named E and R, Handsome Dead Man, Redhead, Comedy Boy, Miss Jane Sloan, who is a writer, and a tiger is in the book. And there's a whole throng of people that are don't have names, they have pronouns. And the book is supposed to be read sequentially, so I will read sequentially for 15 minutes, and then I'll stop. Hopefully not in the middle of a sentence. Okay. I think I'll skip, there's a little prologue, but I will skip that. Okay. And the first point, it's a long point, it's called The Plot Genie. If a person is fawning or obsequious to another, to remove a taboo, to be rid of carping, the desire to obtain possession of a key, insanely jealous love, we are here to escape payment of a lost wager, to secure life insurance, to escape an abomination. Evening, white sand, a small distant figure, tiny sultan, or a speck on the windshield stirring. A natural reality of white summer, of white pain. Once a handsome dead man was floating on the pool. White sand, small distant figure came into view, and you felt a pang of delight under your skull as we drove on, speck on the windshield stirring in white summer of white pain. Then home to read night's starry dismemberment of book, Hamlet's tuck feather drifting down Mallarmé's page, and come morning, we were going up to Portland, backing out the car. It was day. A moose was sighted in the forest. A bus decayed in its interior. The palace gate swung shut. Low, evaporating trails of night terror of what happening. The getting there of next. Let me introduce Miss Jane Sloan, head of the department, and a very capable authoress, dozing off in an armchair near the window, near nature producing its unidentical designs, the chasm side of a stick of butter. The plot genie is baking a pan of biscuits. The plot genie is one of the most virile helps which has ever been devised. Someone is falling into an ancient cave comfort, barely touching another origin, dialing a unique number and none other, holding the plot genie in the hollow of an arm while careful not to bend, spinning while out the palace gates trots a horse color of gray, dark splotch. Soon we are approaching the studios to say, was it better than a painting? To get even with someone? To use a colloquialism in the light of a game or a sporting event? In the house of shadows, the shadow of the house. In the house, I hear nothing but laughter, weaponry, airy plumes on helmets, war relics, and attic wasps. In the dusty corners, parasitical words having drunk of an antiquity by whose forces Europe ruled. The house resting blankly in wintry afternoon, curing in the sun like a little ham. The plot genie's hand reflected in the lake, her hand smudged in the flat palm glare. In a bunkhouse, underworld dope den, back of a music hall, in a bachelor's apartment. Betty, then Veronica, meticulously dressed in the margins. Archie never drawn too quickly, but with patience, exactitude, in the white rapids he might one day shave from his face. Always speaking in the simple human tongues that Sappho kept going, admiring their clarity. To be free, and 21, to be born into a lush landscape and to come back to it in a box, as if in an old evening suit. The genie tells you what happens, and you listen, as if in repay for the years the swarming locust has eaten. The genie tells you what happens, and then along come still others to explain. If you still don't get it, the plot genie repeats. As a child, Miss Jane Sloan came upon a diamondback rattler. On a Girl Scout day camp, s'mores and wieners, old gray sheds, blisters and sunburn, at least one case of bull nettle rash on a bare ass. Mutts drifting above weedy paths like automata surveying an earlier globe. The diamondback did not rattle. In hot noon sun, pungent sulfur smell of snake, the child body of Miss Jane Sloan alarmingly tangible as she walked backward, nervous spasms beneath her white socks, high grass parting like disinterested third person standing aside to let her pass, to let her back so far away, just far enough away so she could still see where, look, there is a wooden bench just strong enough for her to stand on. It was a beautiful sunny day. A peculiar speech signal could be overheard between suspects. I was afraid I was about to permit an unrecognized sister to starve. A relative had decided to jump a bail bond. Part of a body, or a portion of the spoils, was found in the possession of the subject. And Miss Jane Sloan went down. She went down the white road of aftermath, no Titanic. She went down the alterations of to the barely beyond, where everything was begging everything to come back to where we live. When Miss Jane Sloan closed her eyes, she could feel slight neuronal embraces caving in, tuned to the vibration of other tormentresses. Whatever salts there, the dust eliminated. Destiny is a world apart.